So it's my first Barcamp talk. I have been on talking with, because I'm a developer for Mozilla. So I was talking on Skype a lot, but it's the first for a face-to-face talk. So I don't know how it'll go. I want it to be more conversational rather than I imparting some gyan, because generally that makes people sleep. So I am a college student. I used to sleep in all the classes. It does not interest me. I'm a marketing guy, so all HR classes, go back, sleep. So I don't want that to happen. So if you have anything, just shout out. I'll answer your questions. And I don't know how it's going to be, so I'll talk more on the... So basically, I'm going to talk about accessibility. So first thing is, I would like to thank you on behalf of 283 million people. And why 283 million people is because it's a WHO's data of people who are suffering from some level of visual impairment. It could be complete, it could be partial, it could be, you know, progressive, static, different. There are huge number of differentiation there. So these are the people who are, you know, who are, according to the latest data, do have some problem with the vision. And who, so basically you cannot stay away from technology in today's age, right? So what I'm going to talk about is how, so basically briefly about my story without all the boring stretches, quickly. And then I'm going to talk about what are the accessibility tools that I use. And maybe if we have some of the developers, how can they make sure that those tools, it's not something that huge, okay? People think that you make an app for accessibility, then you have to make an app from scratch, which is a myth. You don't need to do that. So if you have any questions in between, want to throw a virtual tomato, rotten tomatoes at me, do it on my Twitter handle. Please, go ahead. It's @ruchir89. So it's RUCHIR89. So appreciations or whatever, because BCB13 is a huge stream, okay? So I don't know if I did fair, not fair. It's massive to go through the stream. So please, if you are doing that, use hashtag, but do mention me so I understand where I stand. And this is my second Barcamp, actually. First Barcamp was the BCB12 in November, I think. November or October. So, okay, so how it started is, I was born with, I'll quickly finish this part. So basically just to make an understand what are the hurdles that people generally face. So wherever there is an option of innovation, there you can pitch in and solve the problem. So it could be in life, in professional, in personal, in any way. So just to widen the scope, I'm just telling about how it worked out for me. So it's born with a retinal problem. I got operated, the operations went bad. That's okay, sad part, we'll skip that. What happened is after that, I went to, so everybody suggested that this guy should go to a special school, okay? Special school as in the government hostels. It's horrible, it's terrifyingly horrible to go there and study, because people want you to make clay pots. People want you to do stuff that you really don't want to do. I wanted to do something extraordinary, okay? So I figured out in 6 months, I was like 4 years old, figured out, no, dude, I mean, this is not working, okay? I'll just come back. So I came back and I wanted to study something serious, like all of the other peers who are studying, okay, at that age. So I tried to go to the schools and said that, you know, I can perform, just take me in. And very few people, very few schools actually came forward and said that, you know, 99% of said, we don't have the facility. See, that's the myth, okay? That's another myth, that if you have to accommodate a visually impaired or at some level guy in any form of disability, forget visual, okay? If somebody have motor disabilities, if somebody have any kind of hearing disabilities, if you are including them with you, it's like you have to spend extra. You have to put down resources to it. I strongly believe we don't. Although there are exceptions, I'll talk about it also. So now the school came forward. So I got admitted into a normal, small-scale school. And I did pretty well. There's one thing I figured out in the early age, okay? This is funny, and this is true also. So there are two ways to attract attention. When I was young, I thought attention of girls. Now it's applicable to everybody. So there are two ways, okay? Broadly. There could be many ways. There are two ways. One is your looks. Okay, you're born with certain looks, you're born with certain physics, and, you know, that impresses. And the other, that you can improve upon slightly, okay? I mean, there's only so much you can do with which you're born with, right? And the second part is your intelligence. These are like proper turns on, okay? If you're able to help somebody when they are very feeling low in exam, you're a friend for life. So I figured out I have to focus on studies because I love limelight, okay? And I was a guy nobody wanted to come forward and talk to. So I figured I have to give something to the society. So the society comes back and talk to me. At least talk to me. Forget about interaction and playing and all. Talk to me. So I started studying seriously. And therefore, in the normal school, I was the rank holder, pretty much 80-90% throughout. So what happens is when you are in school, okay, education is a bit of a problem. There is an opportunity. See, because a lot of teachers read it from textbook. Okay, and I had a session in TechLash about OCR, you know. So if somebody, in 1990s, I think the OCR was not even there. So what my mom used to do is she used to read out the text to me. And then I used to photocopy notes. So the thing that you guys do in college, I used to do in school only. I was one step ahead. So I used to photocopy notes and read it from there. But then I figured out in 8th standard, there's something called speech thing. Like, you know, computer can speak. And eventually got in touch with people, searched a lot of forums. So it's a long story short version. I got introduced to accessibility. It was very basic Windows 98 era, which used to crash more than it used to run. But it was better than Millennium, I swear. But okay. So there was a very limited accessibility in terms of speech because Microsoft was not sure what to do. So there was no narrator and all it is right now. It was not there in 98. It was not there in Millennium. It was very bad in XP. If you have heard Microsoft SAM, it's horrible. So that's another engine from Microsoft, which is really bad. So I got introduced to OCR. OCR is a kind of a technique wherein I used to put my book on the scanner. It used to read out to me. So that was awesome, okay? Because way back, I had no idea about e-books. I was coming from a background wherein I used to ask people and they used to say, okay, you go and do arts and become a professor in some government college and impart Hindi. And I'm like, ouch. I mean, this is not, I mean, I was told right from beginning what I'm supposed to do, okay? This is the path set. And I always used to be like, no, dude, I'll not do this. I don't want to do this. I'll do something different. So I got into, so what I used to do is, I used to open INI files, you know, system files, right? The system files that hold all the variables in Windows. So I used to wonder how these things work. So I started exploring, understanding INI files, and I started coding. I started coding in CCPP. Eventually moved on to Python and later, and got into Mozilla. That's coming up next. But I used to do that. And OCR is a big help, okay? So if somebody wants to work in the field of OCR, just make sure that we can use today's phone cameras and some kind of connection with such a server computing capability that, you know, you can scan the book with a camera and read it out to you. It's not only helpful for people who cannot see. This is only 40 million people who cannot completely see. But there's a massive number of people, 80% of people who have low vision or vision, they can make out, I mean, they can see what is happening, but they cannot read it properly. Problem would get solved for a lot of people. That was a problem way back then. And I used to scan each page throughout. So basically, you just pick a book and read, right? I used to pick a book, scan it overnight. At morning, I had the whole soft copy ready. And that is also like some 90% or 80% accuracy. So I used to understand that, okay, this word is missing. So this sentence means this. So maybe, you know, this will mean like this. So I used to study like that.
Use a device for that? Or
no. It's just a scanner. And the computer, it's the OCR, the engines, there are like fine reader engines, and there are engines, if you Google OCR,
okay.
There's a whole wiki article for that.
Okay.
So it's just as simple, that's what I'm saying. If you actually dive down into it, there is nothing extra that you have to pay for accessibility. Same goes, and I'm going to talk about accessibility in detail, this is just a quick thing. So, and then I figured out, because I was a coder, I got a copy of commercial screen readers. Now, this is the problem, okay, earlier when there was no technology, people who used to work on it charge like crazy. You know how much a software, licensed software, which reads out text to you cost way back then? In 2001, it was $999 US. And if you want to compete, that's the only way, okay? And that's why in India, people are like, okay, we'll do with the Braille, buddy. So nobody wanted to go ahead and buy the software and experiment in life. So I think I took some initiative. There is now, thankfully, a free version. It's called NVDA, Non-Visual Desktop Access, that I worked on way back in 2007. It's a Python-based screen reader that works on any version of Windows. It's a portable thing. You can carry it with you. Plug it in and computer will start speaking. So we have come a long way from those eras where you have to scan. Then ebooks came in, Kindle came in, life became easier. And in college, professors teach with PPT. So that helps. But in school, it was horrible. Let me talk about, then what happens is, I wanted to do, as usual, I wanted to do science. And there was a hurdle in terms of chemistry, so I couldn't take chemistry in the school. And I understand that I cannot, because there's only so much of technology can do. There is a limitation. If you are pursuing your dream, you should pursue it realistically, okay? There are things that I know I cannot manage. I cannot take a sodium and mix it with nitrate and do something crazy out of it. You need to look at it, okay? So I understood I cannot do it. So I took commerce without being rebellious about it. You have to be humble. You have to accept the facts that every human being have a limitation. You also have. Everybody has. So I took commerce, but then I wanted to take computer science. I was sure from 8th that I'm going to be computer science because I was coding when I was 14. And that's because I had no sibling. My dad was a marketing guy, always out. My mom was always at chores. And the only thing that kept me busy was A, Legos, and B, computer. So I was like, there was nobody in the town to play with me and all. So I used to spend all the time reading INI files, reading help files, going to forums, talk to people. I used to be like on IRC for like ages. I mean, I used to just be there. And then, so I used to learn. I come from a background of IRC, pretty primitive. So what happens is, then I used to go to college and there was a problem in handling the physical circuits, right? You have to use, it's a technical thing for a guy who's doing software. He needs to understand hardware as well. So there is a physics and there is understanding gates, like equation gates and all. So I managed it somehow, professors was cooperating. I figured as you go up the ladder, people are ready to hold your hand. It's the initial stage that is really bad. Okay, once you've proved that you have 80-85% in 10th and 12th, then people start slightly believing you. Okay, I mean, this guy is not going to waste it. Even in college, my dean gave me a sort of a challenge. It's like, if in first exam you cannot score, if you fail in any subject, I will cancel your admission because I don't know how will I teach you. It's only you who's coming to me and saying that, yes, I will manage. That's why you're here. Otherwise, I don't care, okay? I mean, so I aced out the first exam pretty much on 90-90%. So that went well. I used to be studious right from beginning, okay? Because I had to. Because I had to prove to everybody this, yes, I can. I always never fought for something like, you know, extra advantage kind of a thing. Because I personally, this is my personal opinion, you all can agree, disagree. I do not believe in quotas. I do not believe in reservations. I have never been there, and I could have taken a reservation and got into an extremely high professional MBA college, but I didn't. Because I stand by principles. It's very important to stand by your principles. So I never took a quota. I always took a general category, and ace exams through that. I never took a PH, physically handicapped quota. So what happens is, then I got into college, and things got easier because that was my passion. Technology was my passion from beginning. So I understood OS, and I understood how IPC work, how COM interfaces work, how process communication works, how exactly the software is speaking out to you, okay? And so that was pretty much the beginning of NVDA that is right now, and all other things that I used to do at the time, because I understood OS very well. See, making an application software is easy because you're developing an environment that is going to interact with the, it's slightly tech. If somebody have any problem, I'll try to simplify it, but I don't know how will I simplify COM interfaces in IPC, but I will try. I mean, if somebody is feeling that it's too technical, let me know. I'll try to simplify. Okay, so what happens is, then I understood OS and I started developing. So when you're making a screen reader is software that everybody uses. It's like whatever is on your screen, okay, it reads out to you. So let's say example, if I boot my laptop, it says desktop, my computer 1 of 16. So basically, you know, there are 16 items, you're on desktop, you're on my computer icon. For that information to relay to you, first the application has to ask the OS, where is the cursor pointed? The OS will return some stats. It will not return like a my computer, it will return some calls, okay? And from there, the software has to identify that, okay, this icon is for my computer. So what happens is then, so I started understanding OS and COM interfaces, and I started working on NVDA, a couple of other projects. So let's get on to accessibility now. Then I long story short, I'll just cut it now. I got into marketing, I got completed my marketing, and so the biggest challenge of my life was not school, not college, not even MBA entrance. My biggest challenge was employment. Because then the company is paying you, right? So when they're paying you, they need to get the maximum out of it. And there are millions of MBA grads, okay? They're like people who have done marketing and MBA, they are like huge. So why would they hire you? So what happens is then I sat for a couple of interviews. So I expected at least the MNCs, the tech MNCs, to come and hire me because maybe they would be aware. I was so shocked that the Indian branches of those MNCs came and asked me, say, how will you work? And I had no place to go, okay? I was like, I mean, if you come and ask me this, then to forget about Indian company hiring me. And ironically, an Indian company hired me. So now what I do is I work as brand executive for Titan Industries, Tanishq Jewelry Division. I manage the entire digital property for Tanishq, all the social media assets, e-commerce in terms of analysis and strategic decisions, basically. That's what I do right now. Thanks, my throat was dried. That was a break. Thanks. So Titan Industries is one of the fifth largest company in terms of revenue generation for Tata Industries. So yeah, we are pretty much a 10,000 crore company. And so yeah, I mean, I'm happy what I'm doing right now because it's technology and best of marketing. You got to strategize, you got to talk to people, you got to meet a lot of company. So now the tables got turned, okay? I was a programmer and now I'm in a client side. So these guys come to me and say, like, at least empathize with us when you're saying that this is deadline, boss, you got to deliver. So I was, things changed and I was client, I was a developer before. But anyway, so this is my short story. How I look accessibility is, if you want to understand the true meaning of accessibility, right, you got to split it. Accessibility, that's how you should look at it. It's the simplest definition I'll give you. The ability to access the content, just like anybody else, is accessibility for me. So let's say if you make a website, I do not expect you to make another version of the whole website for me. But I expect you to properly, when you're coding, keep in mind that this website will be used by so many people that you cannot imagine. You know, you can only put up a flash and a fancy stuff, but all this is going to miss by somebody who is not looking at the screen. Nobody thinks about it. People think that, you know, website's more robust and all you make it, but so it's a different thing. No, it does not come to you naturally. That's why I never wanted a huge kind of following, but I just wanted to send the message across to developers mainly and people who are, you know, talking with developers to when you're making something like an app or a website, okay, you should think about people who are not looking at the screen, how will they access it? So let's say if you're making a website, most of the visually challenged people skip it through headings because we can jump through headings, heading one, heading two, heading three. That's our device. So when you're making a website, please make it structured. It's a basic etiquette, but it makes more sense to people who are navigating it through only headings. Because what happens is if I activate my software, it started reading from the top, saying Google, Home, Gmail, Calendar. It starts reading line by line. So if I want to navigate to a particular section, let's say what's new, it will be very easy for me to go to what's new directly if you have a heading in your website that says what's new. Under that, you can put anything. But as long as the website is properly structured, we're cool. And also, there's a thing called W3C. It's World Wide Web Consortium. Nobody goes and validates their website against it. But it's like the standard, practice, okay? So when you make a website, if you have not closed the HTML elements properly, or, you know, let's say in terms of if you have not given enough emphasis on accessibility, that's the thing, it'll also throw up a warning to you that, boss, this is not the right way of coding. It will not be accessible to the devices. It's w3c.org. So just go and validate. It's a free validator. You can go and validate a website there. It really helps. It's just 2 seconds thing, but it makes more sense to people who are navigating. So that way you make your, let's say, content accessible to a lot of people just by following the basic practices. As simple as alt text. You know, you put a lot of images on the website, right? This is, again, coming from a developer's point of view. So when you put image, there's a thing in HTML called alt text. So therein you can define the alternative text if that image is not loading properly or something. For me, screen reader does not read images because it's a content finally, right? It says graphic. So I have no idea what that image is showing. If you can just, if the developers just pulled alt text and say there's a shark swimming in the ocean, that image is going to make sense to me. A lot of people who have their logos, they don't put up an image of describing the logo, let's say graphic, and there's an alt text saying T written in the Titan Industries way describing the logo of Tanishq. So I understand that what the graphic is trying to say. Okay, that's about the website. What happens in case of programs is the same thing follows for the programs, okay? When you make a program for a Windows or a Mac or a Unix or a Linux machine, all you have to do is label your controls properly. So there are next buttons, there are previous buttons, there is execute button and all. If you're just going to put an image there so basically if there is a radio button, okay, and you don't write mail there, you just put an image of a boy, okay, so it's going to say radio button, unidentified element. I would not know what this radio button is going to do unless and until you have a either text it or put in alt text to the image, okay. And so this is a thing, this is not rocket science, it's just basic etiquettes when you're coding. People tend to ignore it because it does not occur to them that, you know, if I don't provide alt text or if I don't provide anything like this, what is going to happen? This is going to happen. You're going to lose out to these 280 million people. And out of them, I think, sadly, none of the Indian government website is accessible. I cannot go to IRCTC and book a ticket. Ironically, I can go to Snapdeal and buy. But I cannot go to government website and book any of it. You know, I cannot book tickets. I cannot go to Air India and book a flight. I cannot do that because nobody is concerned. In US, you make a website, they will put it down. They will just say, I mean, this is a basic necessity. You better make it accessible. There are cases of people taxing building a societies triple just because they do not have a wheelchair ramp. Simple as that. I mean, because the wheelchair cannot navigate into this society, will tax you higher. And government is very serious in US about all this. But in India, apparently, it's not there. But at least from the developer's point of view, what we can do, let's say, at least this much. And in Android, okay, I have not coded in Android extensively, but I believe there is something called content description. The lint, I believe, if I'm pronouncing it right, is a thing that throws up the warning messages if you're coding something and if you're not providing the proper syntax, you're not following the syntax properly. It throws up warning. That means your app can still run, but there's a warning. So if you're providing, if you're putting up an image, same thing as a website, okay? If you're putting up an image and you're not providing the content description of that image, it just is a button for me. It says button. It says nothing about the button to me unless and until there is a OK button with a OK written on it, or if there is a next button with an arrow of next and there's nothing written on it. It says button. So when you're using the image, use content description so that it describes that this button is next. So earlier when the phone used to be QWERTY, okay, this was very easy for all of us to use because you could remember the keys, you could remember the functions, it used to speak out to you. Now the touch screens are becoming slightly challenging. So most of the people, what they do is for navigation at least, they use a trackball and an arrow. If the Android phones have it right now, they are not, I think they are going to become deprecated. But when you're coding and you're coding the controls of an app, okay, code it in such a way that the controls can also be, other than the swipe gesture, they can also be viewed through your arrow keys. So, you know, you can have, when you shift left, you can see all the controls on the left. With the layout that you're following, just try to make all the controls which are accessible through the arrow. And the center button could be as equal to double tap or tapping it on the screen, you know. So obviously the Android have SDK. There is a accessibility inbuilt in Android called TalkBack that reads out stuff to you. That's a very basic stuff, okay? But when you're designing an app, you need to take care that your control should also be visible from the arrow keys. I personally have a great respect for Apple, not because, you know, they are some fancy people selling high-end gadgets, aspirational gadgets that I have. I mean, I'm still waiting for my iPhone. But because they take care of accessibility in a very very subtle way, they don't become very loud about it. But right now, if you compare Android versus Apple, iOS, the iOS is way ahead in accessibility. And they don't do it. They don't do it for the sake of doing it. Okay, whenever the new iOS gets launched, Apple have a dedicated team sitting to see to it that whatever apps are coming, are they going to be accessible or not? If not, they will tell you, at least let you know that your app will not be accessible to this certain set of people. And VoiceOver handles this kind of problems in a much better way than TalkBack does. So iOS devices are pretty good right now. If you talk about iPads or pods or phones, at least in terms of accessibility, Apple has taken it seriously without being too loud about it. One is saying that, yes, my devices can be used by so many people and leverage on the, you know, on the sentiments. And one is seriously working towards it. I think Apple is doing that. They are seriously working towards it. And these are the basic stuff right now. And OCR, obviously, it takes... See, OCR is not going to be free in the long term on a local computer. Why? Because it involves a lot of coding, because in if you think about English characters, there are 26 lower, 26 upper, there are numeric things, there are special symbols. So once you put an image to the, once you scan an image and give it to processor to identify from every pixel of it, what does this image have? What are the characters in this image? It is a very process intensive task. It requires a lot of coding. But I think with cloud, it is happening when you guys solve a captcha, when you guys have a text there and you solve a captcha, you're actually helping these smart technologies, artificial intelligence, to learn how to scan a text. Next time something like this pops up, what does it mean? When you sign up for anything, you solve a captcha, it is actually making the computer smarter, most of it. So in a way that they are solving this problem, the Google is quickly learning. So I think if there is a technology that, as I talk about in TechLash, that, you know, if there is a technology wherein the cameras are already powerful and there's so much that can be done right now through cloud, that, you know, it's not about, and as I mentioned, it's never like, people used to ask me, what kind of special laptops do you use? What kind of special phones do you use? I have a Nokia E5 right now, which I'm going to check very soon, but I'm going to upgrade. I don't think so that, you know, there is a requirement of a special technology, unless and until it's extremely important for somebody who cannot hear and see. Obviously, braille displays would make sense, right? But for somebody who can see, you go to the airport, people ask you, do you need a wheelchair? I obviously don't, right? It's the same thing. So when you're coding, you don't need to do something extremely extra. All extra you can do is you can make the text resizable. So people who have vision problem, who can only read bigger, can click on the plus button and make the text on your website bigger. That's the only thing. I mean, if you want to make it accessible to people like that, that's the only extra control that you need to put it up there. Nothing else changes in the coding. You don't need to make another version. You don't need to put audio elements. You don't need to do any of it. So, that's something. And accessibility solutions are everywhere. In Windows, it's Narrator. If you hit Windows plus U, that brings up your accessibility center in Windows 7 and 8. It starts talking. That's a very basic thing. And Mac, you have something called VoiceOver. I forgot the function for activating VoiceOver. In iOS, there's VoiceOver again, under Settings, under Accessibility. And how does VoiceOver works is you use your swipe gestures, and it reads out all the elements on the screen. And it's perfect. It's flawless, OK? I don't have an iPhone, but I could have given you a demo if I had right now here. But and on Linux, okay, Linux is interesting. Linux is an open source community. They have something called Genome. Genome have something called Orca. O-R-C-A, that's a screen reader built-in. So if you are on Linux, you have Orca. If you are on Macintosh, so it's not that, you know, if the platform is different, the person is going to access your content. He is going to access it from wherever. So every platform have certain pros. okay, and people are going to reach out to you. And that's why, you know, most of the people try to use, most of my friends use mobile version of Facebook, because the actual Facebook have a lot of changing content, okay? The button will suddenly become a combo box. So my software is confused whether to tell me it's a button or it's a combo box. Then it says unidentified element. So then you go and figure out. So a lot of people use a mobile version of their website. If you can place a control which is uniquely identifiable, that will really help. So let's say when I order Domino's, okay, this is another challenge. I start typing my address, it becomes a combo box. So then it was initially edit box, but now it's a combo box. So my software does not know what to tell me. I think it will improve with the time, because software is also getting developed for that, and NVIDIA is there. And OS has also let operating systems inbuilt have a feature called, for Windows, it's a UI automation. For Linux, it's Genome. So what happens is, this OS supports this technology. It's not like they're coming right now. It's just the awareness is extremely low. That's the only problem, because nobody thinks about these things. They just think, you know, technology is going to make it life easier. For a lot of people, it's going to start working. For they could have never imagined. I could have never imagined downloading an ebook which I wanted to read and just read it without any other help, just through technology. So technology is not just simplifying life, it's enabling a lot of life. And so these are the simple things I wanted to bring to your notice. I never thought I could speak so much. And so yeah, when you're coding, just take care of the basic etiquettes of coding. Do not leave elements unattended. Do not tag everything that you're doing. You know, on Facebook, when you upload a picture, there is a thing called image description, right? If you upload a picture in a description, right, my vacation picture in Goa, that'll make a lot of sense to people who are in Facebook. If they cannot see the image, they're like, oh, this guy is in Goa, okay. So those things are there, we ignore it, but it makes more sense to people. It doesn't occur to me, right? Why do I need to give a description to the image? It's okay, I mean, people can see and figure out. But, you know, that's not the case all the time. So we should just take care of as verbosely mentioning the elements, controls, buttons, whatever, as much as you can, validate to the W3C, because we don't have any standards right now in India for accessibility. I think it'll take another 20 years. By that time, it'll be deprecated. So just take care of these things. It's a basic etiquette, I believe. There's nothing rocket science about accessibility. It's just you code whatever you want. Just properly tag everything. You know, and I read this quote somewhere. I just want to close the talk with that, because I don't know whether. I don't know what are the takeaways for. It could be different takeaways from different people, and we could obviously catch offline on Twitter or whatever. But you know, I just read a quote somewhere that says, and I'll end the talk with this. That says, life's battle do not always go to the stronger or faster man, but sooner or later, the one who wins is the one who thinks he can. You know, that's. So, yeah, I'm pretty much done. I think I'm done before time. But I think that was all the value additions I could have given right now at this point. Because now a marketing guy, slightly disconnected from technology, I have not been coding on Android. I would love to. But I think these are the basic things that I wanted to impart, so that next time you code, just think it from different angle. You know? Yeah. Any questions? Is there any questions? I'll be free to take.
You talks on accessibility outside as well, like, or only such part times you get a chance.
This
if
is my.
You mattered, will you be interested in giving a session on accessibility?
Yeah, sure. Okay. I mean, that's awesome, because it creates awareness. In India,
sure.
It's more required than anywhere else, because in US, governments are sensitive. Here, you go to government, the first thing is they'll say, why you want to use computer in the first place, man?
No.
That's the problem.
Actually, in SAP here, I work in SAP, so we have a team of accessibility. Normally, the people from artistic abilities, they do the accessibility test here. So
okay.
I just thought of checking with you.
Yeah.
I can let you hear.
Sure. As long as it makes life better, anybody's life better,
sure.
Obviously. Does.
It was interesting session.
Yeah,
thank
thanks.
I would You said that mostly we don't have to start from scratch if we are making anything accessible. But yeah. You also talked about an exception, one or two. Could you just tell about them?
So I was saying that if you're making an app which is totally animated, let's say, then there is no way you can put in that accessibility element to it. I'm not saying, I cannot pinpoint a certain thing. Maybe, okay, let's talk about Angry Birds. How will you make Angry Bird accessible? There's no way, right? And I understand that there's a limitation to understand that game. Although there are audio games, how do they work? Is they use the surround sound of it. So basically, I'm driving a car on an iPhone, okay, or on a computer, and I could hear the car sound from both the sides. Okay, it says, so whenever there's a left turn, okay, there's a sound of echo from the left speaker, and it keeps increasing till you take a left turn. Yeah? So game uses these stereo-sounding techniques to make you alert. So if you're walking, okay, there's a pit, and you can hear from your right side the hollow thing, or water running down, let's say. So it's a basic thing in a 3D environment that, you know, towards your right arrow, there's a pit. So you've got to hit control and jump over it. I play audio games. There's a website dedicated to it called audiogames.net. In fact, I would like to show you how I watch movies. That's an interesting thing, okay? I watch movies also. How I watch movies, okay?
Watch movies, okay?
Yeah. I have my bag.
Yeah.
So because the government in US is so sensible towards accessibility, that if you launch a movie, okay, you have to launch the description of that movie, audio description. If you do not, the activist will come and sue you, saying your movie is a discrimination towards me. So this is only English movies, apparently. Again, so you go to theater, you plug in an earphone next to your seat, like you do in Kingfisher, right? You used to do in Kingfisher, sorry. Okay, how many of you have seen Skyfall? Skyfall, the James Bond Skyfall. It's too loud, but it's okay, we'll manage. That's pretty fast, I'm sorry. So boots are... Okay. So okay, one more thing. I don't use mouse. No, none of the people who are any kind of... That's my SAP saying me that there's an additional login requirement. You could go to the browser. That's a notification pop-up balloon that said that. Anyways, so we do not use mouse. None of us do. So if you guys are thinking that you will come up with an innovation wherein you can make the mouse accessible, that's actually not required because we use arrow keys. And arrow keys are as efficient as mouse, sometimes more. So I use Windows M to minimize all whatever the focus was on, go on desktop, and then I'm going to navigate. I'll just slow it down so you guys can understand how it works.
Slower.
That's too slow.
Faster. Slower.
This is good.
Curse wheel. Firefox.
This is Firefox.
Adobe Reader X. Recycle bin. Computer. Tata Docomo 3G. Tiny spell.
These are like sort of American synthesizers, so it does not... In the first attempt, it looks like it's really bad, but...
R. Roger Faladino.
I have worked with it for like 9 years. You're pretty much used to it.
Slower, Roger Faladino. Slower.
This is reading 90 words per second. It's too fast.
Desktop.
But I get bored.
Enter.
If it reads this
way.
Okay. We're just going to play the starting of James Bond. Mm-hmm. I want you guys to just close your eyes for a minute for preventing from any distraction and imagine, okay? Just imagine this.
Now we we zoom out from the eye of a thick maned lion and find him framed by a ring of film. Metro Goldwyn Mayer.
It's nothing. There's nothing on the screen, by the way.
In a painted logo, a woman stands on a tiered pedestal. Wearing a Roman toga, she holds a torch aloft. Its brilliant light shimmers against a silver word, Columbia, a Sony Pictures Entertainment Company. As we peer down a dim, narrow hallway, a trim, athletic figure steps into view. Silhouetted against a sunlit window, he swaggers toward us. As he draws near and halts, a shaft of light hits a portion of his face. We recognize James Bond's piercing blue eyes. They dart to one side as he raises his gun. Clad in a tailored suit, he approaches a door standing ajar. He pauses at the threshold, checking his surroundings. His lowering gaze halts and he fully opens the door. A man in a suit lies dead before him. Facing a bathroom, he finds another man sprawled across the threshold in a pool of blood. Turning away, Bond hurries to a third man, slumped in a living room's armchair near a laptop.
Bronx is down. He needs a medical evac.
Where is it? Is it there?
Hard drive's gone.
You sure?
Bond lifts the demolished laptop and finds no sign of a hard drive.
It's gone. Give
me So yeah, I mean, I have like 400 plus movies. Whenever I'm free, download. A big movie, Bond. Okay, so this is we kind of run all the portals, right? So there's a movie, there's a group which is a closed group because apparently it's another next to torrent. It's like so although I have the login credentials, but this is not the platform. But in fact, okay, let me just open a can of worms. I was the founder.
Oh, wow.
But so there what happens is, in US, right, whenever the movie is aired on the TV, okay, they have something called turn on audio description. So the movie keeps running on the screen. The audio also gets turned on like this. It have all the dialogues, it have all the background music, it have all the pauses. And you could see that the guy is not bored and speaking in some terms as if it's just given to him and he just wants to finish the movie. He just did it, he's actually trying to articulate the motions or the excitement and all, okay. So what happens is, people in US, what they do is they plug in their 3.5mm line-in, pull to recorder, record this thing, and put in the portal. So it's a huge database right now. There are around 3,400 movies over there. So you just go there, check on IMDb, check the ratings, download it, watch it. And I am living here alone. So movies really help. Movies and ebooks are the only thing where you're supporting yourself alone without parents, you know. So yeah, I mean, that's the level of integration outside. We are not aware that's the problem. That's it.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. I have a few things to share.
Yeah.
Just 2 minutes.
Yeah.
You mentioned something about images like graphics.
Yeah.
The images without descriptions, they show up as unknown graphic.
Yeah.
There's one thing in Google Images, I'm not sure if most of you have noticed it. In Google Images, there's an option called search by image. Has anyone used it?
Yes.
Search by image. What that does is, when you can upload an image on your system or anywhere else, you can add a link. I mean, if your image is on some other website, you can just copy the link, you can add that link there, and when you use Google Image Search, it will actually search for similar images. But what it also does is, you will be given the short 2 to 3 word description of the image in the search itself.
Okay. Oh wow.
That is one thing. I mean, that
never, never occurred to me, yeah? Thanks.
That is one thing. And one more thing I would like to share is, there's something called TIN9. Has anyone heard of it? It's something like a similar image search engine. Finding similar images. What that does is, if you have like, you're opening some web page on your browser, you have a Firefox extension, you just right click on the image, and search for similar images. There's an option to do that. When there's an extension in Firefox,
okay.
When you right click and any image and just search for similar images, what that does is it will show you like maybe 100 to 200 similar images, which will also have the description.
Okay. Oh, that's interesting.
That can be really useful. I mean, yeah. If you don't know what the image means,
yeah.
You can always
yeah.
search for it on net and get the description from there.
Yeah. See, yeah. So collaboration power right there. Yeah. See.
Cool. Thanks.
Thanks.
Hey guys.